Barrel Network in New Zealand. So that's where I'm calling from today. It's a beautiful day here. The sun is just about 30 degrees up in the sky, and it looks like it's going to be getting up to about 27 Celsius today. So it's nice and summery.
Nice and summery.
I might go to the beach after this.
Nice. Wonderful, wonderful.
Take us with you, Chloe.
Where in New Zealand are you?
In Christchurch.
Ah, okay. I have a son in Wanaka.
Oh, cool. Yeah, such a small world.
It is a very, very tiny world.
And I have a boyfriend in Waterloo, Kitchener, so not too far.
Not far at all. Oh,
you guys are...
So you'll be coming to visit?
Yeah, maybe next year. He's coming here first. He comes here in a couple of weeks, so that'll be great.
Wonderful. And Justin?
I am in Washington, D.C., the home of lots of crazy people, as the world probably is quite aware right now. So I'm just trying to navigate that world.
It's not the craziest part of the U.S.
Oh, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's the magnet for crazy.
It's certainly where all the crazy ones of all likes gather and profess to lead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, man. Well, as we like to start all of our meetings at Creating the Future, first of all, I will share to anybody that is watching out in the universe, we are watching Twitter, so if you are coming to play along, the hashtag is CTFuture. And if I don't remember to remind people of that throughout the meeting, I hope you guys will. What has been going on in everybody's lives that is awesome? What's the good news? What's going on?
I'll start, if I may. I have my first meeting this afternoon with becoming faculty at a community college for a course in not-for-profit governance that I'm going to be doing January to April. That's, despite all the workshops I've done, this will be the first one that has, like, academic credit involved.
Wow. Wow. Wonderful. Oh, great. What else is going on with you guys? It's awesome in life.
I was just doing an unofficial inspection of a house in Idaho for my parents from Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, which you will know, Doug, who are moving here because they closed on the house. The offer went through. So the biggest decision in moving 2,500 miles away 9 years ago was that I'd be far apart from my parents. So this will start their transition to Idaho by purchasing a home where they can age in place on the green belt down in Boise. So.
Wonderful. Very cool.
Yay. What else is going on with you guys? What's awesome in your lives?
Hey, I'll jump in. And as you know, Hildy and Dimitri already, I was in Belgium last week. And it was an amazing place. And in particular, I got to see the Ghent altarpiece, which probably if any of you have taken art history class, you know it's this really famous artwork from the 1770? I don't remember exact date. But that was amazing. And it was also amazing to be in Brussels. You know, there's so much angst about Brussels and fear mongering and everything. And I didn't feel that at all. I mean, it was just an amazing place to be with lots of people celebrating the holidays, and just goes to show you how what actually, you know, happens in regular life for the most part is not what is depicted on the media.
Boy, is that ever true? Angie,
in 1983, there was some quote floods here. And the wash is filled up, and it is an event when that happens.
And they overflowed the banks. I mean, it was flooding.
It was flooding, but there was one building in the whole place that was so close to the edge that it washed away. And they all knew it was going to happen. They were all there filming it, whatever. So people all over the country were going like, "Oh my God, the whole town is washing away." It's like one building in one place. And
yeah. Yeah. What else is going on with you guys?
You can go.
No, go ahead, Chloe.
I got a real treat. Michelle Bowens came to New Zealand from the Peer to Peer Foundation, came to New Zealand for a couple of weeks, and he's been a massive hero of mine for about 4 years. So it was amazing spending time with him and scheming with him, and we've got some cool stuff going on now, the work that I'm doing in Christchurch.
Now, was that related to Inspiral, or is that...
Inspiral brought him over for a tour and arranged that. Yeah. But he spent a lot of time with different groups. Yeah, and I got to spend time with him in two different cities, so that was fun. I was like the most stalkery groupie.
That's wonderful. I'm anxious to catch up with you and hear what you learned, because that so directly affects the stuff that we're doing here, the work that he's doing.
Yeah, it was great. It gave me like some really amazing frameworks to be able to talk about the stuff that I'm doing. So I was really grateful for that.
Good. And how is your arm doing?
Much better the past couple of days. I have this wonderful cast that has dinosaurs on it. And I've got this until next week. And then I go back to the hospital and I'm hoping that they'll tell me that, yay, it's all fine now. And you just have some physio and it'll be okay. And then I'll be able to drive and eat with a knife and fork and bike and all those kinds of things again. I broke my wrist in a cycling accident 3 weeks ago. So, and type. It'd be great to be able to type with two hands, just one hand. But okay.
We forget that old Joni Mitchell song. You know, you don't know what you got till it's gone. What else is going on, Gail? You started before.
Well, obviously the weather thing, when I was thinking about awesome, the first thing I wrote was no snow, no cold. So that's been really great, especially around here. Gearing up for holidays is always tinged with planning for how you're going to get around the weather, because it's almost always snowing at the exact moment you want to go a long distance. So that's a real bonus in terms of the holiday season, but going to parties and being with friends and family and people is really what we're looking forward to. But I guess I'm looking at the little Twitter feed and I'm looking at the screen and all the people that are in this conversation. And so I think the pinnacle of the awesome for me today is just that you're all here and that we're all here together, and that whomever it is at Vantage Point, I'm not sure, they should tell us who that is, but anyway, it's just nice to see all you folks here. And I'm going to get to see Karen, Jane, I'm going to get to see Karen on Wednesday.
Great.
In Hamilton, yeah.
Okay, well, while you're together, come up with some times when the four of us can meet again.
Okay.
Wonderful.
So I'll go on, awesome. First thing is bouncing off of Gail's awesome. Karen is watching and tweeting that she's here. Kent Schell is wishing us good morning. Maria Turnbull, and I don't know if that's the Vantage Point person, because there's both Maria and Vantage Point who are right now. So that just, it's totally awesome to have all of these people up on the screen and those folks following. So that is from Creating the Future. Personal awesome, in about a week, I am heading over to Southern California to see both of my boys around Christmas time, the wonderful, and to make it extra tasty and fun. Lizzie is driving over here to
my daughter
to be with Hildy over Christmas time, and we're going to meet in Yuma and have lunch together. So, because we're both traveling on the same day, so we're like, have made arrangements to connect on the road. So I'm actually really looking forward to
that. They'll be crossing paths, and Dimitri will head to LA and Lizzie will head home. And actually, Dimitri's going to stay at Lizzie's house while she's here, so she knows that her plants will be watered. And
I promise not to use coffee.
I don't know. Coffee works sometimes. And Carl is here. That's going to be my awesome. Carl's here.
Hi, everyone. Sorry, I'm late.
That's okay. Tell us where you are and what the weather's like.
So I've just moved house. So in the background, you can sort of see the new house, though it's full of stuff that hasn't been unpacked and so on. The weather is cold and a bit wet, as usual. But no, it's good. So my awesome is I've moved house, and I mean the mad summer that I think many of you know I've been having, you know, I mean, has carried on being mad, and you know, we've been running various campaigns and all sorts of stuff just recently, and whilst it's been really difficult for charities in the UK at the minute because they're just getting completely unfairly criticised from all areas, I feel very positive that we are doing our absolute best to try and help them. So that's also my awesome.
Mm-hmm. Wow, it's big. And for those who don't know, while Carl's where he is very micro, where he is in a little bit bigger sense is in the London area in the UK.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. you can tell how life has gotten when where are you is like I'm in my den. Donna, have we heard from you? What's awesome?
You know, I've got a couple awesomes. I had an amazing friend from for a long time who has kind of become a little bit recluse, and we finally got together over wine and wonderful food and spent about 5 hours together on Friday. That was just great. And my other awesome is that I'm getting to be here in this space with all of you. Thank you for letting the two of us tap in together, and it's great meeting all of you. Thank you.
Yay. Kent says that the audio is breaking up. If anybody is out in the Twitterverse, Karen or Maria or anybody else that is out there, could you let us know how the audio is? And Mr. Wizard of Oz will check on that. So, Justin, if you are with us, do you have something awesome to share?
Something awesome to share. I got out for a run, which has been a challenge. So that's very exciting. I would say my awesome is, you know, I've had quite a few opportunities to talk with people who, while still trying to get their head around the work that we do with catalytic thinking, are starting to kind of come around and say, oh, now I see how it all works. And that's kind of nice to finally get folks who are, you know, even though they still feel like they say they don't know what's going on, even though they're doing it all the time. It's kind of nice for them to start acknowledging, oh, this is why it's different. So, that's my awesome. And my video I'm taking out because I'm trying to deal with a technology problem. So I'm here present and hearing everybody.
Cool, but might be like digging under your desk or something. So,
correct.
Yeah. Is there anybody else who didn't share something awesome? I think we DK. DK, I'm sorry. Yes, go. What's going on in your life?
Oh yeah. I'll do some awesome. I mean, the first awesome is being with you guys. I mean, this is really cool. I was one of those Twitter disruptors last time, so I was just out there just buzzing out, and I just said, well, the hell with this. Let me join the gang. Here I am. So I got two awesomes I got to share. The one is the super mondo badass, great awesome. And that is I got married in October. So that's the best. That happened just on the 11th. So I'm just a few months into marriage and it's fantastic. The second one that's super cool is 2 days ago was Frank Sinatra's 100th birthday. And here in town, we had a local or community band, nonprofit, called the Unforgettable Big Band, who was hosted by York Little Theater, a nonprofit, for a concert celebrating Sinatra's 100th birthday. And I'm a trumpet player since fourth grade, but I wasn't playing in this. I got to host it. So I was sort of like the Peter Lawford of the Rat Pack. I got to just like introduce the bands and tell stories about Sinatra music, and it was super fun.
Oh, that sounds like a blast.
It was indeed.
Sounds like a total blast. Wow. Well, things around here have been really, really awesome. I am I am on like a creating the future awesome high at this point, because every single piece of what we're doing is ridiculously awesome. We finished up the beta of Catalytic Thinking 101 this week. Had our last class. Donna, you were in the final of the last of the betas. And I had the honor of co-teaching in all of the sessions, which gave me this wonderful overview. You know, you teach one class and you know what one class is doing. You teach five classes with different people and you get a sense of what the threads are. And the deliciousness of being able to say, we can break this down and we can teach it. And where sometimes it feels like it's, you know, these are ways of thinking. How do you teach ways of thinking? How do you teach ways of being? And, you know, I guess I should defer to Angie and Donna who were in the class. But the sense that I'm getting, at least, is that, yeah, you can actually teach this stuff and break it down. And so that's been really hugely, hugely awesome. And getting ready for bringing all those cohorts together, what Rebecca is calling the all beta love-in, which I this week, which we will get to have everybody together and share what they learned and share what they're practicing and help us, because it was a beta, so help us with what worked and what didn't work and that kind of stuff, and getting ready for the 102 beta that we will develop in the next. So all of that's awesome. This stuff, I just got to tell you, this stuff that we're talking about today has my head just blown. This is so exciting. And Chloe, I so want to know about your conversations with Michelle. And just thinking about different ways to organize and the realization that the structure of an organization can actually be an active participant in furthering the movement, just, you know, makes me giddy. So everything with Creating the Future just feels awesome right now. And the personal awesome is that I get to spend 5 days with my kid. And so I'm just, Lizzie turned 30 last week on Jane's birthday. So that's another, an awesome for you, Jane. That you had a birthday. And so I get to spend 5 days and it'll just be the two of us. And we have a long list of places that weren't open in the last time she was here that we can get to try new restaurants. We're going to see lots of movies. I've saved lots of stuff on the DVR of TV shows that both of us like, and we're just going to play for 5 days. So that is pretty awesome. Pretty awesome. So what I would love to know is Karen and Maria and Kent. What's that?
That was me. Uh-oh. And I want to let our folks who are watching that I'm going to just momentarily see if I can switch systems to improve the audio, because I've been listening to the audio and it is kind of choppy, and I want to do what I can to improve it. Rest assured that this is all being recorded beyond that. So I will upload a final version of this so you won't miss anything in this interim when, as far as this meeting is concerned, we will continue as we go along. This is really a message to the people who are watching it online, that there will be a moment or two when it gets offline, you might need to refresh your page, but it will be back on, and I will do everything I can to make sure that the sound is better than it has been. So. End of technical announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Technology. The fact that Dimitri has figured out how to fit 5 pounds of, 5 pounds of stuff in a 2-pound bag to make all of this work is pretty exciting. So thank you for that. For those of you who see giggling going on the screen, I just want to share with you that everybody seems really excited about Doug Knight's t-shirt that says no profits without nonprofits. And So we have started out with that.
Can I say though, Hilly, it's a battle cry, but it's also truth. There's also truth to this. And it's based in actual economics. It's stuff that I talk about a lot when I do community development work. There's a big push, and I'm sure Carl and the rest of the gang here will appreciate this. You know, you get into these local businesses and these local communities, and there's this battle, at least here in York, in the state of Pennsylvania, in the U.S. for sure, and I'm sure this is elsewhere, where as nonprofits, you know, we're not paying property tax, and we're owning all these buildings and properties, and communities are saying, well, we need to supplement this. We need to get some taxes from them, or we need to get, you know, pilot program, payment in lieu of taxes is a big thing in the States. And my argument always is, well, wait a minute now, we're job creators and we're paying payroll tax and we're supplementing a ton of stuff that communities can't and would no way be able to manage, let alone be able to handle in terms of social services and the arts. And most importantly, if you want to build your community smart and you want to get a new business to relocate into your community, you're going to tell them all these great things about your community. And what are you going to talk about? You're going to talk about your art scene, your education, your environment, everything that we do in the nonprofit sector. So it is absolutely insanity to suggest that we're, if I could, I'd get rid of the word charity. So I don't know if anyone here is a big word into the word charity. I'd love to just ixnay that word. It's just, there's nothing charitable about what we do. And there's nothing extra about what we do. We do meaningful kick-ass stuff for our community. So yeah, a little battle cry, a little punk rock stuff.
Like, we prefer the term community benefit organizations.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and this
nonprofit
this
is such a dopey word, man. We should be for impact, you know. We define ourselves in the negative. It's the weirdest thing, but that's what we are.
This paid political announcement has been brought to you by DK. The one thing that I do want to share with folks is that while many of us sitting around here have been in the community benefit sector, many of us are also in the business world and working solidly in the business world. And that the beauty of the work that we're doing at Creating the Future is really about systems and ways of thinking and practices, that it doesn't matter where you work. I'm hearing echo. It doesn't matter where you work, it doesn't matter where you be, it doesn't matter what you're doing, that as Rebecca likes to say, this stuff works and it works everywhere. And if we are bringing out the best in each other, which is what Creating the Future's mission is, Creating the Future's mission is that ways of being that bring out the best in each other by the questions that we ask is ubiquitous, that everybody knows how to bring out the best in each other, bring out the best in situations by the questions we ask. It's why our motto is change the questions, change the world. And the beauty of that is it doesn't matter where you are, it doesn't matter what sector you are, it doesn't matter what industry you are. We had wonderful, wonderful participation in the last, in the beta for catalytic thinking, where in just about every class there was someone who was in the business world in some way, whether it was in a Fortune 100 company or in a tech startup. And the beauty of catalytic thinking is that it's a way of thinking. It's not a where you work or a what you do. And when we're bringing out the best in everybody, then we stop saying you're not worth it, or you're not worthy, or you're not paying taxes, or you're not. We stop all of that stuff. So that's our paid political announcement for everybody sort of working together and being together. I'm hoping the audio is working for you guys out in the Twitter sphere, and if not, Dimitri is working diligently at it. As he said, it will be recorded and you can come back later, but we really want your input, so I really want it to be working. Okay, deep breath. The last time we got together, we really pushed thinking about what the structure is of Creating the Future. For those who are listening for the first time, a quick review. I'll do it and then I'll ask you guys to add in anything that I've missed. What we're looking at is the fact that over the past 6 or 8 months, it's become really clear that as creating the future is scaling from a startup mode to what it's going to take to accomplish our mission. And we have a 10-year timeline, we're about 2 years into a 10-year timeline to accomplish our mission. It is clear that a structure needs to be built for creating the future to scale its work so that we can spread this mission and that the structure can support that. And we all know structures and systems that thwart the work that organizations are trying to do, and how often we see the people in organizations trying to do one thing and the structure actually stopping them at every point. And so what we're looking at doing is using catalytic thinking to find the structure that makes sense for making this living starfish creature become ubiquitous all over the place so that the mission spreads. And so last time what we spent all of our time asking was, what can a structure make possible? And for whom? And we talked about it making things possible for the people, for the day-to-day activities, for the programs, and especially talked about what it would make possible for the mission, which became very, very clear that it was about the spread of these ways of thinking and asking questions, these approaches and ways of being. And so did I miss anything? Laura's here. I missed Laura's here. Yay! Quickly tell us, Laura, if you would, who you are, where you are, and your weather.
Can you hear me?
We can.
Oh, great. I am Laura Steffen. I am a coach for women entrepreneurs in Philadelphia, and it is close to 70 degrees, and I have all the windows open.
Unbelievable.
Weird.
Unbelievable. And I was just giving a review of where we've been and where we're headed. We were about to start diving in, but before we do, do you want to share something that's awesome in your life?
Yeah, sure. I'm still writing my last week awesome that I posted about in the Facebook group for consultants, that I had a great meeting with a client and she re-upped my contract and expanded it. And because of her involvement, I'll be able to start professional coach training in the spring. So I'm really excited to do all that.
Yay. Yeah. Really, really glad to hear. Really glad to hear. I do love the fact that we have a lot of people who were tweeting last time in the sphere with us this time. So it's wonderful. For those of you who were here last time, is there anything I missed in my description that you would describe differently before we dive in? All righty. I will take silence as I go ahead. Okay. What we want to look at now, what we talked about really was that, and I'm going to read a little bit here, because I tried to summarize this yesterday. I was trying to get my thoughts together, and then it became apparent that we could all sort of glom onto that. That the highest potential of our structure, what it could make possible, is that our mission is accomplished. And that whatever structure we create actually actively helps spread the work that we're doing so that we accomplish our mission. The rest of what we discussed at that meeting, what the structure makes possible for the people and the activities that will accomplish the mission, those include a structure that creates and holds the space for the spread of ideas and approaches, a structure that creates and holds the space for activities to accomplish that mission and the people in those activities, and a structure that actively models our values in action. And what I talked about in that blog post was that when we talk about structure, we're talking about functions. We're talking about stuff that people do. We're talking about what is it that holds up the day-to-day stuff that people do. Decision-making and leadership, coordination of activities, infrastructure that brings out the best in people so that facilitates and develops and nurtures the people, infrastructure that supports the stuff, so administrative stuff and resources and regulatory compliance, and structure that connects and engages and invites, whether that's people who are doing the work within that structure, or inviting people from to join what we're doing. And so I guess the biggest question really, these are starting to look at what are the conditions that a structure needs to create. So let's just start there. Within all of those aspects, decision making, if we want to pick one, or if you want to just sort of think in general to start with, what do people need to feel in order for these structures, these things that we're so used to every day, in order for them to bring out the best in the people and to accomplish our mission? What do people need to feel when they're in those structures? What do they need to be assured of? What do they need to be able to do?
Can folks hear me?
Can, Justin, yes.
Yay! Okay. you know, the thing, and I know that this is sort of starting with the negative, but the one thing that I notice is people won't feel like the system is working against them. Mm-hmm. So oftentimes when, just in general, people feel like, I can't do that because of, you know, the policy, this, the that. Yeah. So I think what we would see is that people wouldn't be feeling like the system was an excuse or a barrier.
Mm. Okay, so if it's not an excuse, it's not working against them, what is it doing? What are the systems doing?
Encouraging them to behave the way they want to and that they feel is productive.
Mm. You know, we had a, some of you who have been following the saga of my laptop on Facebook, and by the way, this right here is, I think, laptop number 4 in 3 months. One of the interesting things that happened, and it was so interesting that it happened coincident with all of this. You get on the phone with tech support at HP, and Dimitri talks to them, and then they do, my favorite word is escalate it, which means they move it to the next person because they have no authority to help you. They are only allowed to say no. They're not allowed to say yes unless it is, did you plug it in? And, oh, good, we fixed it. And at every point they escalated it, they kept telling us, no, we can't, no, we can't, no, we can't, no, we can't. And what Dimitri kept finally saying after a while was, I just want you to take this thing back. And they just kept saying, we can't take it back, we can't take it back. And it wound up in this battle of their systems versus what we as the customer wanted. Eventually, they found a loophole. It took them more hours on the phone than you could ever imagine. They found a loophole where they could actually take it back. The tone of the person on the other end of the phone, it was like somebody had given them, you know, like a year's worth of candy. It was, oh my God, I can do something good. I can actually help you. I don't have to fight with you. It was the most amazing thing to see that they were in a system that absolutely told them they could not bring out the best in themselves or the person on the other end of the phone. And the minute they found that they could do what they really wanted to do, which was help him, it was just amazing. It just so popped for me, Justin, when you said that, is the joy in this person when they were actually able to help was just, yeah.
What I've heard from that is something that's really important is giving people authority to be able to solve problems.
Ooh, yeah.
And I was thinking of the systems are supporting the people, not processes, rules, steps you can take, but the systems are there to support them to whatever the task is, but giving them flexibility in that, not just the system won't let me do it. The system will not let you be human. So what does it look like for systems where you can be human?
Okay, what does it look like?
You're able to make mistakes or take risks.
Mm.
Sounds pretty human.
Yeah. What else?
I think we need to be curious. We need to be thinking, what if, and we tried that, what happened, and what would have happened if we'd done it a little bit differently, and in other words, keep pushing move the structure ideas forward all the time as we learn from what we try first.
Systems that support curiosity. I love that, Jane. So what does that look like? What does it feel like? If you're in a system that's supporting curiosity, what does it look like and feel like?
A lot of times reflecting together on what if we did this? Well, we did this. What happened? Well, was that what we wanted to happen? Well, no, actually it was better. Why was it better? So it's a form of learning. But it's people-driven learning, everybody saying, what if and what happened and, ooh, then how can we make that even better?
The Hangout is back. I'm reading the Twitter stream right now. The Hangout is back, but no audio yet other than alien chirping.
Yeah.
And I'm hearing, Dimitri's working on the alien chirping.
Just tell them that is, in fact, what's happening, but we've all got a babble fish in our ears that let us translate the alien chirping for conversation.
Code. It's our new code language we're working on.
Yes, the Twitter people are missing the babble fish.
I would tell them that, but they can't hear me. So, so what would decision-making and leadership look like if it was encouraging people to behave in the ways they wanted, giving people the authority to solve problems, flexibility, creativity, systems that support curiosity? What would decision-making look like?
Hilde, to the list of things that you just added there about the sort of things that a system would enable, as well as autonomy, one of the things that people really value is mastery, if you'll excuse my accent, or mastery. In other words, the ability to learn and develop a skill that gives people internal or intrinsic value. Because if you look at the example that you just gave of the computer support people there, that system had completely de-skilled them. As well. So not only did they not have any autonomy, they also didn't have any mastery, because they weren't allowed to develop the skills to solve your problem for you. So I'm using that word and that example. You might remember from a previous board meeting, I quoted a book by a guy called Richard Sennett called Together, where he uses the example of the orchestra, and you want to create a system that essentially enables us to build an orchestra where you may well be conducting at the beginning, but everyone in that orchestra, they have mastery over their instruments and what they're doing. They know what their role is in that sort of network of musicians who are all playing together. And when they act together, they make beautiful music.
Are you the one, Carl, or I think it might have been Alex, that talked about the importance of the orchestra that eventually the conductor can just walk off the stage and isn't needed because everybody knows.
I think that was Alex. Excuse me a minute.
Wow.
Another really important thing in terms of supporting autonomy and mastery at Inspiro has been the idea that it's of encouraging people to learn through doing rather than trying to figure everything out and get it completely right the first time. You just start doing things and learn that way, and learn much faster. And in that way, the learning becomes really visible and able to be shared as well.
What else do people need to be able to do?
Fail awesomely. The best thing you could possibly do is have a place where failure is looked at is not negative, but is a showcase of what you've been trying to do creatively, and it's a safe environment. Like, we were talking earlier, Carl had mentioned the thing about the orchestra, and I was looking back at the CT Future hashtag from the last month when I was just on there, and I think I had mentioned something about jazz, which is the same thing. You know, we have a song and we have a key, and you're going to just go at it, and you might not even know what the hell you're about to play, but you're going to go at it and try it. And if you feel that structure around you that gives you the sense of I can fail at this and still be all right, you're going to take more risk, which means you're going to bring more creativity to the table, which means you're going to improve as an individual, as an operator, as a trainer, as a listener to it, as the conductor in the front. To Hildy, to your point, you could start a song off, 2, 3, 4, get the guys going, and you could walk away and let this thing sort of run for a bit. So I'm a big fan of that, man. I think anytime we can allow ourselves to have that comfort area where I'm not sort of the warm and fuzzy guy, as you probably can tell. I'm not that guy. I'm not the warm and fuzzy all the time. But I am about good, safe landing spots. And if you have a great spot that says, look, I can go buck wild on an idea, and even if it falls flat to everybody else, at least I have a place that I can put it out there, and it's gonna land somewhere, then I'm more op than less to come back with some other idea.
You know, I'm relating that directly to what Chloe was talking about in terms of encouraging people to learn through doing. One of the sort of mantras that we have adopted over all of these years of seeing ourselves in large part as a learning laboratory is that we talk about everything we're doing as learning, because when you're learning, there is no failure. So we don't have to talk about failure, and we don't have to encourage people to be okay with failing. If we're encouraging them to learn, then there is no failing. And so we don't have to put that language stuff on them, that if it's all learning, then it's all good. And I love that. And it links directly to what Chloe was talking about, which is the learning through doing. And if you're learning through doing, you're not failing. You're just learning stuff. I love it. Yeah. What else do people need to be able to do to be able to feel?
To kind of build on what Doug was saying, I feel like, I mean, first of all, Hildy, the blog post that you wrote and sent out for this was great. Because all the things I keep thinking, what about this? You've written them down. So thank you. You're really good at that. But I'm thinking about, as far as what Doug said, to give people practice in failure. So because a lot of times I feel like in my own experience, I wait until I know what I'm going to say. I wait until I've found all my facts and practiced my rap, and sometimes I miss the opportunity because I'm too busy practicing or waiting till I have it. And so the faster we can be upfront and saying whatever the idea is, whatever the action might be, and if there's an easy way to capture the information or capture the idea, send it out to people, share it with people, give them an opportunity to collaborate immediately so that it feels like a team thing and not just one person taking a risk, then I think that would actually be living the thing instead of telling people about living the thing.
Yeah. I really agree with that. I think another thing that people, I myself really need this, as well as autonomy, I need connection. I need peers. I need to feel like there are people on my team, that I have allies, that I have people that I can send something to that's like in a really rough sketch and have them go with that. It's like having a really good social environment around everything that I'm doing has made the biggest difference. And as far as we talk about this idea of collaborative autonomy, which is like, it's like trying to give everyone really good personal freedom at the same time, be connected enough so that we become more than the sum of our parts.
And Laura, how you were saying about, you know, all of our preparing and making sure it's perfect, and there is no such thing as a perfect moment in this structure because it's a steady, comfortable presence. So they're not moments, but it's how you're always going to feel comfortable and supported in stepping in whatever it is that you're stepping in to share or explore. Comfort is always present. So it's not seeking perfect moment. Just like in practicing the practice, there is no perfect.
What else? These are so amazing, and they're all so interrelated. You know, I have to say that every time we talk about this in no matter what environment, I feel this structure. There's something weird about the way we're talking about this that it's because I guess you get a sense in any place that you are you get a feeling in a place. Sometimes you get an icky feeling, sometimes you get a sterile feeling. Every time we talk about this, I get this sort of sense of, I love that collaborative autonomy. I get some of you who I've been talking with about this, I keep feeling this as sort of a beating heart, that there's this structure is alive. And I can't put my finger on what that means exactly, but there's something that feels very alive about it. Rather than, I guess maybe in comparison to what Justin was talking about, as rigid and Rebecca, you as well, rigid, and go.
I've been muddling with the words that resonate for me in this place and in other places that I've been, and I guess it's this, there's a sense of intimacy that people experience with each other, even if they don't know each other. And I've been thinking about that, and especially as it relates to the phrase holding space. So there's sort of a deftness about how it's facilitated, how it's led, that where people seem to know or have a sense of what in a different setting we used to refer to as the dance, which is knowing when to lead and when to follow.
So, and
that breeds intimacy. Right?
Yeah, and so let's play with that a little bit, because a lot of what you were talking about, the deftness of how it's facilitated and led. First of all, I just like that phrasing, so thank you. The word hound likes the phrasing. What would that look like? Decision making, the leadership. What could that look like if it is accomplishing what we're talking about here?
Well, it'll be neat to hear what other people think, but I could imagine that it's a feeling that you are simultaneously deeply engaged and yet free, kind of flying. You know, I don't know how else to describe it. Deeply engaged, yet not stuck.
I'm listening to you and thinking it's an ocean. It's like a marine ecosystem where each creature can go its own way, but gather together as they wish to, as they need to, in order to thrive. And if everything's working well, it expands. There's more fish, there's more whales. I don't know if we can go outside this nice little community and say, it's alive! But if you talk organic or ecosystem, then it's the way I feel we're talking. Because part of the ecosystem is interdependent and dependent and still has free will. To do what matters to them.
Jane, I'm laughing because I did a blog one time and it was called The Franken Idea. And I titled it, It's Alive. It's a Franken Idea. And it was this whole idea that one idea is not the answer. It's actually a group of a bunch of ideas that sort of meld together and create into that. So anytime you can get, like I'm a huge fan of places and spaces that it gives you this sense of like a design or an advertising agency would be. And if you take this into the sort of the for-profit realm and you know, those great ideas don't don't happen by just sitting at your cubicle kingdom alone and then walking into a staff meeting and saying, here's what I thought about on my own. They're going to go into a real community space. They're going to have whiteboards all over the place. They're going to have, you know, I mean, I'm constantly sitting here with whiteboards and sticky notes and everything around me. So when everything comes around, I start sticking stuff up on walls and then somehow saying like, okay, how do I connect these dots and bring these all together? So I think if you take that to a structural standpoint, if you actually look at organizational stuff, you want to make that like we want to be the whiteboard that everybody puts up their own stuff. And then we somehow connect through strings and other sticky notes and everything else. And then that's where your conductor, that's why you have a kick-ass person like Hildy at the helm who can say, oh, wait, I see how we can maybe put these things together. And then those that don't, it's, you don't feel like, oh, I got left at the door. I'm not going to the prom with anybody. You don't feel that way because you're in the midst of it anyway. You're kind of doing your thing. So anytime you can have that, I mean, I love the ocean analogy too. That's pretty great because you can always say, well, I don't even know. Let's just go that way. Inevitably, we're going to see something else. Let's try that and see what's going on. It still has structure, but it gives you that vibe that you can keep moving out and keep exploring.
Well, and if we didn't have the ocean analogy, we wouldn't know, as Laura has just posted in the chat box, that she's a seahorse.
I'm thinking to when Chloe was in the podcast with Hildy, I think you spoke a lot about Inspiral, and it's having this place where people can step in and they shape what's meaningful to them and how they want to contribute. So I think about there's such latitude in how you're stepping in to all that's happening at once at Creating the Future, then in one place you will just naturally perhaps step forward in leading something to Gail's dancing. Like the ebb and flow going on the ocean as well of lead, follow is naturally going to emerge. And it's not looking at, well, who's, you know, it's going to be one of these five people leading it. There'll never be a list of who's going to lead these things.
Yeah. So, it's interesting, as Jane was talking about ecosystems, I was thinking we as humans have a tremendous capacity to disassociate from the connection of what's around us, and we create these systems that separate us. And so part of what I would be looking at and thinking about is the intentionality, I think, to going off of what Rebecca was just saying, is if I'm in a system that's supportive and enabling, it also, the system is geared towards purposefulness, towards intentionality, which resonates with what I think is both bringing out the best in me and my community. And I think that that's, you know, when we talk about community benefit organizations, when we talk about people who feel they don't have work-life balance, it's because of that disassociation. They don't feel like the purpose of the systems is resonating with who they want to be or the way they want to see the world. And so for me, flip that around, the systems would feel very purposeful.
Can I add too to that then, Justin? There's a sense of urgency to achieve the vision, but it's in balance with what people can do. We're just working with some folks right now who, I mean, I just was thinking about it this morning. What is the one thing that every time we work with organizations or people who are wishing for something else, when you ask them what would it take to get there, they almost always say time. If we just had time and more time. So it's that sense of urgency that we need each other to get this done, but we are going to do that in a way where there's a balance of life and work and effort and fun and creativity, and that the structure actually is designed to create those things.
You know, Gail, it's interesting when you say sense of urgency. Urgency is so often related to time, and what you just, the words you just said, is a sense of urgency that we need each other to get this done.
Yeah,
the urgency is about each other.
And yeah,
that's really,
yeah,
yeah. I'm playing with the. So I love the fact, Jane, that you put this in the ocean, because when we put it's one of those things that you know, when we sometimes talk with groups and we say it's 100 years from now, so you don't have to worry about payroll, you don't have to worry about anything. You put it out in the future, so you don't. And dealing with this as an ocean ecosystem it allows us to disassociate from a whole bunch of communities where we have to think about being human. The thing that's playing with me, and Justin, you said people shaping what's meaningful for, as somebody said, people shaping what's meaningful for them, is that if we're in an aquatic ecosystem, there's different ecosystems that you're sort of connected to, and they're all functioning really well within themselves. And the whole thing about there being rules, the rules in that one ecosystem are real different than the rules in this one and the rules in that one. And there's a big piece about that, I don't know, it's sort of forming in my head that it's, they're connected, but they're separate, and they're allowed to be separate functionally because that's what makes sense here, and it doesn't make sense there. And decision making and leadership and infrastructure and all of those things make sense in this way, in this place, in this way, and in this place, in this way. And so long as the through line is there, then yeah. Okay, I'll stop now.
There's something onto the really cool thing though, Hildy. That I think if you had to define what this space should be, I think it is that you are that throughway. I mean, that's the idea. I'm thinking at least is that we have all these problems, and these problems are huge and they're daunting and they're difficult. And then on the other side of the coin, we have the stupid grant that I got to write, and I just got to think of that one word that I can't think of right now that I need to put in this sentence that I think will get me that grant that's going to help me on the very small, you know, getting that one person to say yes. So I got this range of ridiculousness that I'm dealing with on a day-to-day. And somewhere in there, I got to think about my own personal value system and my own leadership and my own way of dealing with donors and volunteers and, you know, run the gamut of where that is. And then, oh, by the way, I have to think about that from a .com perspective, a .edu perspective, a .gov perspective. And I think if you really want to lay out a really cool way to define what this movement can do or maybe should do or is doing or however you want to say it, is that, you know, that's part of what we're trying to do is be the ones who can help all of us conduct our way through this, whether it's, you know, again, if you take the ocean metaphor, you want to run on that one, you know, we're not the ship. We're not necessarily even having to be the ship's captain. We're the really good compass. Like we can just say, hey, as we are right now, we're heading south. I don't know if necessarily that's the best way. It's the way right now. So let's figure out what we're doing. But if we do turn, we know what that could mean. We could bring in other folks and other ideas, or we have some knowledge of what was south before, and now let's go this way, you know? So there might be something about this that, when asking to put this into the reel then, right? Like how do you build this board to be a one structural thing with some intent and purpose, like Justin said, but also give it its flexibility. Maybe that's it. Maybe it's by defining it simply as saying, we're not necessarily defining all this other stuff. We're the in-betweens.
Okay. So DK, you just like did this for my brain. Okay. So one of the things that we've been talking about is that legally, in the state of Arizona where we're incorporated, we need one board member. So if we stop assuming we need a board, and we talk about structure, and we talk about decision-making and leadership, what might that look like? And the thing that occurred to me as you were talking is, what if the structure of what creating the future is just the ocean? And yeah, the ecosystems exist, and it's just, how do you define the bubble within which they exist that allows them to exist in the way that they can and thrive over here and thrive over there? But you're creating you're the water. You're creating the thing in which they exist that allows them, that makes possible, that facilitates each group being what it needs to be in the way it needs to be. And the through line, as it always is with us, is our values, is catalytic thinking, is our mission and our vision. And if that's the water, if the mission and the vision and the values and catalytic thinking saying these are the questions we always ask, and these are the order we ask them in, because that reflects our values. If that becomes the ocean that everybody's swimming in, then we know that what this ecosystem does is going to maybe be very different than what this one does, but that's going to be the water.
I totally agree with that. I think that's a really interesting and innovative way. I think it moves things away from the most structured thing. There's a sad irony in this, because some of us on the consulting world, right? We get paid to help build a board and a bylaw and a, you know, and to do it this way and say A to B to C to D. And I think we're at a point now where, especially in this day and age, we have to look beyond the agenda. You know, it's nice to give an A through G, but screw that. What else can we do? I mean, what else is the ways to do it? And there's another group, Gail and Justin and I are in this other thing that's happening here in Pennsylvania. And I think I'd mentioned this there, so I might be copying my own words here, but we looked at it and we were asking the same sort of structural question. And I sort of said two things. I said, one is like the legion of superheroes, right? You have all these great superheroes that do these amazing things, have great powers, and have great responsibility in certain areas and countries and cities. But sometimes they all got to get together because that's what's needed. But they are not needed all the time and not all at once and not every single one of them. Teams are banded together and then they disband and then they come back. But they understand they're all part of this bigger ecosystem. Or like in the States here, right? I mean, when we started and we broke away, sorry, Carl, when we broke away from Mother England, you know, we had our states, and then we said, well, let's just sort of confederate a little bit here. Let's have our thing, and you can have your autonomy. But we also got to think bigger here, what it means on this level. And we'll get together every so often and talk about it, maybe put a document together, but we'll make it so it's good and solid, but also loose and creative enough that you could take this back to your state and figure out something else to do with it. I mean, I think that would be neat, because that's the kind of group you want to line up behind and or stand with and say, let's meet this future head on. Let's go with them.
Chloe, what have you experienced? I know that when you and I were talking in the podcast, you were talking about the model that you guys currently have, and wondering how much bigger it can actually scale before it becomes, you know, less functional or not as functional as it has been. Is any of this like resonating in terms of what you've experienced?
Yeah. I mean, if you want to build an organization that is like very human shaped, then it also needs to have human scale. And so that's why I've put up a link in the chat to this idea of Stigmergy, which is what happens kind of beyond the human scale, because the human scale is when you, you know, you hold some kind of intimacy or relationships through knowing people, right? And so in Inspiral, we've developed well because we've actually been like a high trust local network. But now as we're becoming bigger, we're nearly 300 people, and we're spread out all over the place, and many of us don't know each other. Some of that is starting to break down, so we're having to figure out how we kind of like split into like smaller cells that are now then connected in that same way. So it might be like, you know, if we're going to take the ocean metaphor, there's the whole ocean, and we need some kind of like coordination mechanisms across that so that we can just have awareness of what each other are doing, so that we can continue learning from each other. And at the same time, we need some smaller communities in there that are able to be highly productive because there's trust and there's like knowing of each other. But one key initiative that I'm working on at the moment is trying to figure out ways of how to like better ways for Inspiral for us to find the strangers that we need to collaborate with in the network.
Within the network.
Yeah, within the network.
Yeah.
because at the moment, generally, because of the information systems we have or the information systems we don't have, because it's all been very informal in human scale, it means that it's really hard to find the people that, unless you know someone or you talk to people and they know someone, it's really hard to find who in the network is going to be useful to you and help you achieve what you really want to achieve.
I'm thinking with catalytic thinking framework, our framework is our structure. So if, you know, creating the future is the water, it doesn't matter wherever you just kind of swirl into or go full force in, it's still going to feel comfortable to you because you will see our framework in practice. So whatever structures that are specific to this project or to this initiative, it's going to be familiar because you'll see the values in action. You'll understand how decisions were made. It's always about who else cares about this and what resources already exist. So even if the structure is different over here than there, it's the same framework has shaped it. So if I'm just stepping in to see what's going on over here, one, I know I'll always be welcome because it's always about the people and not the thing. And whether I choose to dip in fully or just see what's happening over here, you're always going to have that same intimacy and comfort because we'll build the things that need to create that for anyone who steps in at any point.
You know, it's funny. I've been thinking easily for a year now. And Justin, you're the one that did this. We talked maybe 2 years ago about bylaws, and you're the one that was sparking the thinking of bylaws not as dictate, but bylaws as a process document. And what has occurred to me in the time since then, and gets stronger every time I think about this stuff, is that our bylaws could be one page that say, here's our values, we embed our values into everything that we're doing, we walk the talk of our values, and here's catalytic thinking, and here are the questions that we always ask. So all the crap that's normally in bylaws is how often will you meet? You'll use catalytic thinking to figure it out. How many board members will you have? How many whatevers will you have? How will you be structured? We'll use catalytic thinking to figure it out. And it's so... The link between that and what you just said, Rebecca, is just so clear to me that if the framework is at the heart of all of it, then it allows those cells to all form on, as Chloe was saying, a very human scale. Because I think that's really important, is that it has to be a human scale.
Well, it strikes me that what we're really talking about is culture. Because culture, I mean, that's what values, the manifestation of values is the culture, or that it is how we interact and how we determine the way in which we think. I mean, that's what culture is. It's how we behave and how we think collectively. And so, you know, I think that that's what you're really talking about, is a structure that propagates that culture, that it is one, and that culture is, you know, fundamentally grounded in an approach to thinking, which is the catalytic thinking, you know, an assumption that people deserve and can bring out the best in themselves and others and the world. And I think what other people are saying is the commitment to kind of learning and inquiry. I mean, that's fundamental. The catalytic thinking is, it's question-based. It's not answer-based. And I think that's what's taught. That's, you know, when I talked about any policy being a process document, not a dictate document, it is the idea of how it enables people rather than controlling people. So the note that I posted earlier, but the idea being whatever we put down and try to codify is always something that should have reflection built into it and be focused on the human nature. And it goes back to what Chloe was saying of things having to be on a human scale. Culture can kind of go beyond what we feel as an interpersonal human scale, but it manifests in the interpersonal realm that does need to be very, it needs to feel comfortable in terms of navigating. So that seems to be the underlying thing, is really owning what it means to be driven and to be creating a culture actively as an organization. And I mean, for all the talk about on the for-profit side of, you know, the most successful organizations are the ones with strong cultures, they don't seem to talk about what it really means to define and hold culture particularly well. I mean, I think the idea is valid. It's just, it's not demonstrating itself the way some of us would think it should.
I've been at some sessions on that. I fully agree we're talking culture. One of the reasons it doesn't work in a lot of for-profits is that the culture at the top that they think they're creating bears absolutely no resemblance to the culture at the working level. So they talk strategy, culture eats strategy for lunch. Well, because they're trying to impose the culture of a few people on the many, and they're naturally not going to succeed in that. I just love the way the conversation's going, because Gail and I are both familiar with an organization local to us where they said, we'll do everything in constellations. It sounded kind of neat, self-forming groups, and tackle a task. But if you think about it, in a constellation, the stars are in a fixed position compared to each other. Some are brighter always, as we see them at least. They don't change much fully over eons. So, yeah, they formed them, but they weren't flexible. And if they didn't like the way, if the people at the top didn't like a particular constellation's direction, it just disappeared, and there was that black hole in the sky.
Well, right, just that, just those words, Jane, the people at the top, that, you know, yeah.
We're trying to avoid that in this fluid situation that we're navigating, since I seem to have now got us talking water constantly. Cells or schools or groups can move from one to another as they want to. Everything ripples, so everything anyone does affects all the rest. It's to some degree or other. It's so different from this fixed constellation thinking, where whatever you pick as a structure, well, that's it. We can start it, we can end it, but while it's there, that's it. Whereas this is all going to change minute to minute as people interact.
So it seems to me then that another one of the conditions is also a deep commitment to a sense of generosity, that because if people are coming and going, and if it's not as fixed as we have traditionally seen structures to be, then there has to be a way of welcoming and continually updating, or I can't remember the right word for that, but, you know, orienting people to what's going on so that they don't feel like they're an alien or an outsider every time they want to participate, or, you know, that sense of, oh, I haven't been part of the conversation, so I'm not sure I'd really be able to follow it or whatever. So some attention to practices that make sure that people understand at all times that they are welcome and they are part of things, which goes back to it's like a zealousness as we understand the need for each other. We cannot succeed unless everyone is involved.
So I'm looking at the post that I sent out to you guys yesterday, and I'm looking at those structures, and this is like, I may have shared with some of you in the past that I frequently use the analogy of as things are starting to make sense in my head and starting to come together, that the gases in the universe are starting to congeal. I don't see planets yet, but I'm starting to see planets. So I'm beyond gases congealing stage. I'm actually starting to see planets, because what I'm seeing is each of these structural things, decision-making and leadership, coordination of activity. And Chloe, you talked about that need for coordination and coordination of both the activities and the communication so that everybody is learning from each other. Infrastructure that brings out the best in people, infrastructure for the stuff, the connecting and engaging and inviting piece that Gail had talked about. Each of those can be embedded into whatever those ecosystems are inside the bigger ocean. So decision-making happens over here. It's self-governed. It is coordinating the activity. So let's use the actual stuff we're doing. Let's talk about education. We have lots of education programs. The education ecosystem, which may have lots of little ecosystems coming off of it. So one person wants to, you know, one group is looking at doing webinars, and one group is doing this curriculum that we're creating, and they're all self-governed so long as we've got these principles. So long as the ocean that they're swimming in is the principles and the framework and the values and the culture, then we know that as you said so beautifully, Rebecca, that if I'm coming out of the initiative that you're starting, the sharing stories initiative, if I'm coming out of there and I go swimming over to this one, that I'm going to recognize, I'm going to feel comfortable in that ecosystem. But that each of these happening within the framework autonomously get connected. Yeah.
Yeah. See, like music and musicians have figured this out. And I think this is where I always go back to the jazz thing. Like as a trumpet player, I can say to myself, like I can self-identify. I can say, well, I like playing jazz. I like playing blues. I like playing rock. I like playing this. If the topic du jour happens to be classical music and I'm not feeling like I want to play classical music today, or I don't think I have the stuff to do it, I could sit out of this. I'm not out of the band. I'm just out of that song. Or if I feel like I've got something that really I can just showcase and put right up front, then I'm going to stand up and play that solo that I've been working on, and I want to share it with you. That's there. But through it all, there's music and there's keys and there's tone and there's, and all those things. And if we replace those words, that's our value and our voice and our, you know, that's the infrastructure that we put in. That's the invitation. I love that. It was just pointed out, invitation being one of these big parts of the mechanism here. But it also doesn't, it doesn't turn this into, which I think is the fear, if I could be the guy who just says this, right? We've all been in these networking groups where the networking group literally takes all its time to say the hellos, never does anything. And you're like, I just walked out of here going, what? We didn't do anything. It was great. I got to say hi to friends, but what do we do? Like the get action section has got to be the big thing. Well, if we have the structure that Hilde, you're talking about, look, I'm pointing like you're right there, like Hilde's right there. if we have that going, then we're going to be able to get into the get action part pretty quickly, because that's like being in a jazz band. All right, guys, we're take the A train in A, 2, 3, 4, and we go. So that the structural thing will actually allow for greater creativity and all that. I think that's going to be really cool about this, is if we establish it under those guidelines of like, here's a value, and we're way about, you know, invitation in. What do you play? Great. Sit here. Here we go. We're going to do this. I think that'll be really cool.
The analogy of, I'm sorry for having been out of this here for a while, but I think the sound's working out. The analogy of a band of some sort, be it a jazz band or be it, I reflect on, my youngest was in a steel drum band, and the way the teacher taught them steel drum was not by learning music. He gave them the ballots, and they sat down and imitated what the others were doing. So they were immediately part of the program. And it wasn't this long period of, oh my God, I'm not reading music correctly. I don't understand, you know, what a treble clef is or whatever. They just started playing, and by Christmas time, they were playing music that blew me away. I mean, they were actually playing songs and doing all kinds of things. So I love the music analogy and also the invitation, because that's really what that is, Chloe. That is an invitation that you're part of this now, and not, you know, once you have passed some litmus test or once you have, you know, passed the I can read music test. Yeah, you can play music along with everybody else immediately. So I really enjoy that. And can identify with that metaphor.
I'm thinking about what we've just wrapped up with the online curriculum with the beta cohorts. It's like, it's everything that we know works, but it's scaled across the whole movement now. It's how are people being welcomed? How are people always starting with your winding path of life? Because that's walking the talk of our values of relationships. So it's everything we have done with a cohort of 22 people to welcome them into this online community, but it's now scaled and replicated, which is the very essence of our mission already in action.
Chloe, can you talk a little bit about the project that you referenced in the chat? And I'm going to go just turn the heat on a little bit in here so I'm not disappearing forever.
Sure. So when I came into Inspiral in 2012, there were only like 50 of us. And so it was much easier to be able to navigate the system and find your place. Now with a much larger community, there's so much going on in the organizational system. We tend to talk about an organizing system rather than organizing structure. Is kind of being reflected on and is evolving every day. And for people coming in who aren't necessarily like practiced organizational designers, they come in and go, what the hell? Like this just big giant spaghetti monster, what's even going on? And how do I engage with it? And so we kind of joke about like you come into Inspiral and you choose your level of information overload, but when you come into Inspire, you have an initial 3-month period, which is kind of like a trial period, and it's not you being on trial, it's us being on trial to see if we're like a good place for you. And so what we're trying to do is put in some better information systems. So some information, we're creating a little app which has orientation information and says, you're new here. How about you do this first and then read this and then you can do this. And it just creates some smaller, easy steps for people to help them build relationships and understand the system. And then the other thing is putting in a better social process for welcoming people. Every person that comes into Inspiral is invited by one shareholding member. But what we're trying to do now is I've just established a welcoming crew of 12 people who are really excited to be welcoming and helping orient new people into Inspiral. And they become every new person that comes in now has a buddy. And that buddy works in cooperation with the member who invited them over that 3-month period to help understand and, I guess, improve the experience that those new contributors are having. But this is still a work in progress. It's been going for a couple of months now. And there's, you know, we just have a couple of little working groups that are on it and everything. And we really welcome the new people that are joining to be part of these working groups as well. So that part of like their meaningful place is to start off with is actually improving their experience and then kind of like paying it forward to other people.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm so grateful for the fact that you guys are learning all of this and exploring all of this, and that we don't feel so alone. So very much what we're talking about.
I'm connecting with more and more groups around the world who are, and there's last week I talked to two other groups that are similar to us. And we did a share on like, how do you onboard and welcome people and how do you orient people? So we shared learning at that level as well, which I find really exciting.
Yeah.
Excuse me. And the really energizing thing here in this community, this sense of community, is that we know that we can develop that the definition of welcome together, and probably will continue to do it again and again and again, And actually, that's something that we know from experience works, is that we never assume we've got it figured out, right? And that takes it back to what others have been talking about in terms of stiff structures that that can't be moved within, right? As long as we have the belief that we will always be making it better, we'll continue that conversation.
Yeah, I think it was Carl that said, whatever we codify should have reflection built in. And that kind of reflexivity is super important, but it can get overloading as well. So it's like, it's important to have some kind of balance between, yes, you can like assume these things are like structurally sound for a while. Like this is solid ground that you're on. And this bit here is like, we're rebuilding that bit at the moment.
I've been drawing. I've been doodling, and I'm not sure you guys are going to be able to see this. So I'll hold it up and I'll pray. What I've been playing with is, so you've got like an educational area, and I've also been reflecting on the word commons, and I've been reflecting on that. Oh, maybe for the past two meetings where we've talked a lot about. Where the word comes up every once in a while. So if each of these is sort of a commons, where everybody gets all the things that we talked about, that decisions are made in place, that the through line is all those arrows in the middle with the red that says the ocean is supporting and coordinating and inviting and providing some structures. But the thing that I like about this, as we're talking about it, is so if there's this ecosystem in the ocean that's about education, and I've got an idea, I'm you know, Joe in Spain, I've got an idea and I want to teach it, that it's not up to a board to decide or rules to decide. But that the project can sort of be, if the project embodies everything that we're talking about, then it's an education group that decides, oh yeah, there's a fit here, and guess what? We also are about coordinating and learning and inviting and supporting. That all of those things, you know, Justin, how many times have you used the word fractal? That if everything we're doing from a project that somebody gets an idea of a project of what they want to teach, And what happens within that project has all those pieces that it plugs into, and so much of what we talked about the last time was on-ramp. So it sort of, you know, it plugs into the port of oh, okay, well, that's an education thing. So come into this education ecosystem where it's decision-making and infrastructure and support, which also plugs into the common ocean, where if there's something that doesn't make sense for one, but that has all, I mean, they're just, I think that if it's fractal and that all of those things are within, that there's a way that, one of the things that's bothered me for a long time, and you guys have heard this, especially you guys who have been on the board or have been in conversations, is the notion of who gets to decide. And the notion of a person or a group that gets to decide who, frequently as organizations get larger, have less and less connection to the thing they're actually deciding on. So if decisions are made locally among the people that it is affecting, but we know that the framework and the values are at every level of that fractal thing, then we don't need a board. For sure we don't need a board. We don't need the top down. We don't need yeah, I'll stop now, but this is...
I'm really curious at how this is resonating with you, Chloe, and the your hands-on experience with what you've been working with Inspiral. Because this is a really big thing. So I'm really curious as to your reflection.
Do you guys have, because I know that you've got individual entrepreneurs working on individual projects and much collaboration. Are there Are there groups of like common theme that spend a lot of time together and
there's 18 different companies in Inspiral. And so each of those social enterprises, they have their own team and all that kind of stuff, and they spend a lot of time together. We also have, like in the structure, we've got contributors, and then further in, we've got members who are the shareholders of the Inspiral Foundation, which is the entity at the core. And when you're a member, you're a kind of really active guardian of what's going on. So you're kind of in Lumio in our decision making and discussion space every day. You're actively thinking about, what are some problems or some holes that I'm seeing here? And then you put up a proposal in our collaborative funding so that you can get paid to do that work. I think we're just about to go through what we're calling, just over the next 3 months, a refactor. Which is like a little bit, refactoring is like a computer term, but it's basically just when you, if you've been working on a project for a while and Inspiral is 5 years old, you kind of go back and see, okay, is the structure working? Is it actually, you know, like what you guys are doing, is it giving us what we want, or are there things getting in the way? So we're going through a bit of an organizational audit at the moment. And that came about just because there were four members who decided to form a team, and they put a proposal for a 3-month sprint on this to the rest of the members. The rest of us then gave them a whole lot of feedback over a week, and they then reshaped their proposal, and now it's going out to be passed by the full network as a decision. And, you know, so we don't really so much have theme areas, though we do have like particular people that are like really geeky on organizational development stuff versus people that are just kind of in the enterprise and wanting to make that succeed. So we often think about having different citizen types rather than, you know, so you've got the people like me who are hyperactive citizens. There's like a motto of like all the things all the time, and you've like worked for a number of the different enterprises. You understand a huge amount of the systems. You hold a high number of relationships. And then there are people that really focus just on one project or of one venture. And then there are people who are kind of just supporters and don't necessarily earn a lot of their livelihood through Inspiral. I think, so we've also been doing, as part of this refactor, we're wanting to create what we call a minimum viable board. Because at the moment, the board have been this kind of group of four elders elders in that they've been part of Inspiral since the start. So they have the most kind of historical institutional knowledge. And they've been doing a lot of thinking and problem solving and trying to keep this thing afloat. But we now moving to a minimum viable board. The role of the board is really just to make sure that we're financially and legally compliant. And then we have systems that enable other people to govern and lead. Because working with the legislation in New Zealand of being a company, like there are some things you have to make sure are covered off, and you have to have a board of directors. But we're trying to make sure that those people don't have to be the people who are also designing and developing the organization. So yeah. Really separating those things. And also that the biggest company in Inspiral, which is Inspiral Services, which is a pool of 75 freelancers in different teams, composed of a number of different teams. I'm just about to be leading a refactor of that, which is, so I'm basically putting out the call now to the whole network, to the whole company, saying, hey, I'm going to be establishing a leadership team to lead out on some of this stuff because of what I've noticed has been going on recently. Who wants to join me? And that invitation is completely open.
And then as whoever comes in, we'll put a proposal, a cost of proposal to the group, and then that should be passed.
I love what I'm hearing. What a great idea that you got a few people who are just focused on the regulatory compliance, because, you know, maybe you can legally only have one, but that wouldn't make me feel confident that I didn't have to worry about it. But if there's three or four people, then, you know, life happens, somebody will pick up, they'll make sure among themselves that they do that kind of overseeing. So this is the governance wonk speaking. Boards govern, but obviously there boards govern if you haven't designed something better. And for decades we've been saying, well, we, you know, boards aren't working right, but, you know, what could we possibly do instead?
I'm writing that down, Jane. I boards govern if you haven't designed something better.
Oh my God.
This is the first time I've ever heard a better in two decades of listening to that question be asked.
Wow. The thing that's striking me, Chloe, as you talk, is a couple of things. One is everything, all of the systems that you guys are developing, you're developing based on the functionality of it, rather than on anything that should be. So it really is answering the question of what will function best and what the functions we need, and seeing that whole regulatory compliance piece as a function rather than as the overarching governance structure is so different than corporate anywhere, nonprofit, for-profit. The other thing that's really clear in what you're talking about is creating ways for freelancers to plug in. And so many of the people in the Creating the Future realm are now and will be freelancers, if to use that term, in a lot of different ways. Whether, you know, Donna, that's because you're plugging in because you're out in the world doing your thing in your organization and your community. You want to plug in whatever it is that you want to plug into. But those two things are really clear to me in the stuff that you're talking about, Chloe. And again, that compliance piece can be part of that ocean that supports everything. So if instead of seeing the thing, and I really hate the whole sense of it being quote at the center and that things plug into it, because there is no center when you're talking about an ocean. That if it is the thing that supports everything and holds everything, then one of the things that everyone is going to need is to make sure that that thing is legally compliant, is financially compliant, is resourced, has the infrastructure. For instance, you need a website, okay? So that is part of the ocean. But the thing that Rebecca happens to be working on, or DK happens to be working on, or Justin happens to be working on, could be a piece of the website, a place of the website. It's not the whole thing. I mean, so this is just making very, very clear sense in my mind.
And Chloe just posted in the chat a point-by-point goals, I guess, of what they're trying to accomplish. Chloe, I had a question on when I present a proposal, if I heard you correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Is this voted upon, or I lost track of what happens.
And to whom? So
who am I presenting it to, and what happens then? You know, and do I get, like, not voted in, and, you know, then what do I do? Or if I get voted in and I don't do it, then what happens? What's the responsibility relationship and connection there?
Well, the way that we tend to see it is, and I guess this is because a lot of us have a background of being freelancers or contractors. It's like you would draw up a contract. You put the proposal to the widest group of stakeholders that this is going to be affected by, essentially. And it's not that you put it out and you were like, yes, vote for this, yes or no, and it's kind of like a majority thing. That's not how it works. You put out a proposal as
suggestion, and then you create space for other people to say, to improve it with you, you know, to bring their intelligence to it as well. And then after that, you would put it to a vote. And so, for example, if different kinds of decisions need, yeah, like I said, it's the widest group of stakeholders. With financial decisions, it's usually the shareholders that make the decision to pull money out of reserves, our reserves, and do that. But with any other decision that's like affecting our organizational agreements or anything like that, it goes to the full organization, so over nearly 300 people. And we operate our decisions by consensus. So that basically means that everyone has the power of veto. Anyone in the whole network could stop it going through. That very rarely happens. You don't have to get everyone to participate in the decision. The idea is that everyone has the opportunity to. So you do a vote, people agree, abstain. They can disagree, in which case it means that they have something that they can offer to improve upon what you're doing. So sometimes it goes through a couple of iterations. A proposal like this would go through a couple of iterations, and we have Lumio, which is our central decision making space, a piece of software that we wrote. That's one place that we make a lot of decisions. And then the other place is this tool called CoBudget, which is where we every month we have some discretionary money to spend, essentially some of our profits that we want to reinvest back into the mission. And anyone can put up a proposal there for funding, and people who have contributed financially to the organization then spend the money that they've contributed on the projects that they want. And so when and you can discuss proposals on there as well. So it means like I have an idea that I want to do this update on the website. I will put it up in CoBudget, and if people like it, they will fund it. And if it only gets partial funding or it doesn't get funded, then I can decide what to do. I might want to improve. I might want to change the proposal. I might want to just let it go or whatever. In terms of the accountability piece, a lot of the time we don't even have like legal contracts or anything like that. It's really you're held accountable because by your social capital in the network. Like you couldn't afford to, and it's like that what a couple of people have talked about needing other people. Like you wouldn't do anything that would like cancel out your social capital, because then, you know, you don't have that resource of that whole community behind you anymore, which is hugely valuable.
That's great.
Yeah. There's so much. I'm so glad this is being recorded. So glad this is being recorded, and I'm so glad that we're capturing the chat and saving that as well, because there's so much rich stuff in there. One of the things that I'm reminded of as you were talking about your process for approving projects, to put it in typical lingo, is the decision that our faculty team made maybe 2 years ago that we would not qualify people to teach. We would prepare people to teach.
Mm-hmm.
And that rather than a qualification process, it would be a preparation process. And that's really so much of what you're talking about is an attitude of yes and an attitude of inclusion and an attitude of possibility undergirding the invitation to participate. And it is an invitation to participate, not a qualification process for someone in some moves.
The thought that comes to my mind is that each step creates community. So if I was a vendor and I came in and I did my contract, whatever it was, my proposal, yay, nay, I'm in, I'm out, it has done nothing to build community, but me to that community to me. And at every step, as you're describing this, and as I think about this, everything you do, whether it is funded or not funded, just by virtue of the fact that part of this process builds community. So
yeah.
That's really, really interesting.
Builds the social capital.
Yeah, because of the social capital. It's sort of like the eBay effect, you know, how many people like you versus ones who don't. You know, you're not going to sell much if they don't like you. So, meaning you're not a good person to deal with.
So I think there's something really interesting. I don't know how many people noticed, but when Chloe, you started to get to that accountability, the expression I saw was, well, we don't even have to worry about that. I mean, we don't have a system for accountability because we haven't built accountability as the outcome. The outcome is the process, the relationships, the trust building. And so I was just thinking, you know, again, perhaps it's semantics. Well, it's not semantics because there's an idea, but the idea behind building things that are set to accomplish a requirement, we have to be accountable. We have to fill a regulatory goal. We have to do our governance. Those always seem to break because the requirements and the regulatory pieces and the accountability, those are all reactive. Those are all because something didn't work the way we wanted it. We put in these stopgaps for everything. And I think what Chloe's really describing is a system that's built around, not designed to accomplish specific things, but to enable relationships to build, enable effectiveness to actually blossom that's there. And so again, some of it has to really do with our framing of, you know, so much of what we consider structures for is to control,
yes,
not to enable.
Yes.
And so every time we talk about having to have accountability or meet legal requirements or all this stuff, we're falling back into the control thinking, not enabling thinking.
You know, Justin, what you reminded me is how many of us that are governance geeks talk about and use the phrase accountability to what end? If we were to put that in the framework of creating the future, in the framework of catalytic thinking, accountability is a condition to what? Is a precondition for what? If we aim at the for what, we'll create the conditions for that for what, and we don't need to worry about the accountability. It takes care of itself. And that it so fits into exactly the framework, is what in Spiral is you're talking about, Chloe, is you're creating trust relationships, you're creating social capital, you're creating interdependency, you're creating a collaborative environment. That's the so what. And if you're creating that, then you're creating all of the conditions for that to happen. Accountability feeds into it in a very, very different way. Accountability becomes
a kind of theme or learning theme from us for this year is that what's more effective in getting good work is making sure that people are supported rather than like trying to hold them accountable. If they have support, you almost just don't need to do the right kind of support for them. You almost don't need to do the accountability piece. And we've found that because accountability is something that's has come up quite a lot. You know, it's kind of like when you build a certain level of social intimacy, like in your family, you can start to kind of take that for granted a little bit, and standards can start to slip a wee bit. And we want to be like a really brilliant business organization. You know, we don't want to be just this kind of fluffy community and that kind of stuff. So, we've just found that the mechanism of support is to back people up is more effective in getting good work than kind of like coming down hard on people and saying, you didn't deliver. You say, hey, I've noticed you didn't deliver. Why is that? Can I help?
Yeah. Well, you know, Chloe, when you mentioned family, before you sort of said we fall back, I was thinking, I don't have accountability agreements with my daughters. I'm not building my family structure around tasks and accountability. I'm building it around trust, love, you know, support. And there's no reason that does, you know, again, when you take those constructs that we've created and put them into, you know, intensely human and personal experiences like a family,
Yeah.
Perhaps a healthier family. You know, suddenly they become absurd. Like, yeah, how many, I don't walk into my house saying, it's now time for me to be accountable to my family. What do I have to do, you know, one, two, three, to do that? Or to govern my family? Like, it's just obscene.
And at the same time, you need kind of processes or approaches to dealing with, oh, like, this person let me down. What are we going to do about that?
Which is the equivalent of, my kid didn't put the trash out.
Yeah.
I mean, it's truly, and I hate to do this. We are 1 minute to the hour. I could have this conversation for another 3 hours. And I'm just, I want to be mindful of time. I want to express the deep gratitude to all of you. This deep breath. Let's do a little bit of reflection before we sign out of here. And I'm really seeing what's next here as our pulling all of this together, because I think that we can pull all of this together and start talking about a structure. I think that we've been designing this today. That around the conditions we have been designing this, and are you guys feeling the same thing in terms of what's next? I'm feeling like we could design this.
Mm-hmm. there was a comment from Kent Show, which I think is really relevant, and that one, he calls this model extraordinary, what we're talking about here, and I think, Chloe, what you're talking about. But also, in this case, the organization itself becomes more and more intelligent. And I love that comment in terms of thinking about, in this case, the movement becomes more and more intelligent in what it does because of the relationships it's building. So thank you for that. And thank you for your patience in coming back in, Kent. I think we lost a few of the audio issues, and Kent persevered. So thank you, Kent.
Thank you for that. And so I will ask all of you, what are your reflections? What is standing out after this incredible conversation today?
I'll start. I mean, well, many of you know me, but I think it's affirming that this is all possible. I mean, Chloe, you have a great example, and I'm sure it's got its challenges in front of it, but you know, I think that this is demonstrating very much that it is possible, it is realistic to think in these terms, and that's affirming.
Very much.
I think before Angie leaves.
Angie?
Yeah, I have to go, sorry.
Reflections? We all have to go, the reflections? Mm-hmm.
I think, I mean, it strikes me that importantly, what we've been talking about can apply to so many organizations that we're associated with. And so how do we take that out and make things work in a way that's more supportive of everyone, I think is, yeah, really important. Wow. Thank you. Sorry, I have to go.
No, thank you.
Same here. I'm also really encouraged by this group of people, and as well as the folks that were in the Twitter stream, just the opportunity that the conversation is broadening, that they're, you know, a sense of confidence that whatever is developed is going to be the result of some pretty amazing minds and perspectives coming together.
I have to get going too. I feel like we're a bunch of like wild radicals turning everything on its head that we've been taught about governance and that people expect us to say. And I just put in the chat, I got to go talk to somebody now about teaching a traditional governance course.
It does feel weird.
And it's just going to, it already felt way outdated to me when I looked at the outline, and this conversation has just proven that it's nonsense.
Yeah. Jane, if I could just share one thing. I've been doing a lot of stuff that's been interacting the crossover between governance and finance and all this stuff. And when I start with redefining fiduciary, not redefining, but reclarifying that it's about shepherding resources and the advancement of a community goal, it turns all the governance on its head, because then you just ask, what would it take to be able to do that as a person in the organization?
And wow. Can you type that into the chat?
Well, yes, I will.
I really have to run.
Thank you, Jane. What is standing out for the rest of you?
I was thinking about...
Go ahead.
No, go, DK.
No, I was going to say, this is how revolutions start right here. This is how it all begins, you know? I really do believe that there is... the way that we can move these things forward is just by doing this. It is stepping off and doing it and knowing full well that there will be hiccups and problems, and there is nothing wrong with a hiccup, and there's sure as hell nothing wrong with a problem, and that's where these things really get great. And I think it will foster more and more creativity. And as Kent mentioned in the chat about talking about how this will make this organization by itself more and more intelligent, I think it speaks to this larger idea of the old school model was get your organization together and therefore the community will blossom. And what we're saying is no, blossom the community. Organizations then in and around it are going to kick ass because the community itself is speaking to itself. And I think that's the best about this, is that we're looking at this. It takes this sort of the jargon stuff, the holistic and all this that we've been talking about for years and years and years in the sector, and say, enough theory. Let's go. Let's put it down and roll. And that's, I think that's what's going to be exciting about doing this. Very punk rock. Very punk rock.
Chloe, what's standing out for you?
Just a kind of like excitement and optimism and hope of with the number of groups I'm now having these same conversations with. And, you know, it's so many of us in Inspiral and other kind of radicals that have been forming over the past few years have felt like we're really doing it on our own. And this year, I feel like that's changed. This is actually a bigger movement, which gives some sense of inevitability to its success that we haven't had before. So I find that really, really amazing to experience. Thanks for having me along.
Just so grateful for you. So grateful. Well, Rebecca, you started saying something before.
We talk about being in scale-up mode at creating the future, but there's such strength in it because of that whole, I think Gail said it, that the urgency, the sense of urgency is because we need each other, but it's, we want each other, and the each others are growing, like, because there are more people in the world that are all part of this movement. So the more we're inviting and the welcoming, and is you feel more and more strength. And to your point, Hildy, I absolutely see that your gases are forming those beautiful planets indeed.
And I think for me, it's been really fun to be a part and listen to everybody. It's the systems for me that have not felt right. This feels right. And I think that's happening with the big swirl here in Idaho, is there's finally something that is beginning to feel right, and we're ready to jump in. And so thank you, all of you, for all of the amazing insight, the ideas, the craziness. It's exciting. It's hopeful. Like you said, Chloe, brings me hope. I've never been more hopeful. In getting involved with this great group of people and seeing what's possible. So thank you.
Thank you. How about you, Laura? What is standing out for you?
Oh, I was just thinking, first of all, I know you're not the ship. I know that you're not at the head of it, but I love watching when you say the planets are starting to form. I'm like, oh, thank God, because I don't know where we're going. it feels like a very, I guess what I realize is I'm living the thing you're describing. You know, I hear you say we want to do this. I feel totally supported jumping in and saying, I don't know what the hell this is, but it feels really great. And so just knowing that all these people are thinking that something needs to happen here and we think we can do it, like it makes it, I don't sit here thinking, oh my God, how am I going to do this? It's more like, ooh, what can we do? And so that's the whole, that's the thinking in motion, right? So I was just thinking, wow, it works. So that's it.
Yeah, yay. Dimitri, what's standing out for you?
A couple of thoughts. One, that this is a taking down of barriers, that organizations, the structure of an organization is kind of a barrier. And this is sort of saying that isn't there anymore and or doesn't have to be there. And that seems really right. It feels like it's the next thing that needs to happen. Then I was also reflecting on when Chloe was describing the bid process. Somebody puts his bid in, and if it isn't, then they work on it. It reminded me of Nemawashi. It reminded me of that the approach of, I have an idea, but it's not, it doesn't happen until everybody inputs on it, until everybody participates in it, until everybody hones it. And now that idea becomes something that is open for everyone, that everyone is participating in. And that's really what this engagement feels like, is that people are participating in, and so it's yours, it's theirs. You know, it's not mine, it's all of ours.
Yeah. The whole Nemawashi concept is, if you guys are not familiar with it, Dimitri, would you type it into the chat so that they can?
Oh, yes.
N-E-M-A, oh, yeah, I can type it into the chat.
I can say it.
There we go. Okay, no problem. Mine is very personal. And that is that as a founder, I've been doing a lot of work, a lot of writing on the stuff nobody thinks about in founders. I'm tired of the words founder syndrome. I want to punch people when they say founder syndrome, because what we've done is we've created systems that are so entirely dependent on the unspoken characteristics of a founder that we then bitch that those systems are in place. And so what I've been looking at is sort of deconstructing all of the, okay, what are the unspoken things that a founder holds? And what does a founder hold the space for? And what is both the joy of that and the overbearing sense of responsibility that if I don't do it, it won't happen? When we first started teaching this, one of the texts that we made mandatory, required, was The Starfish and the Spider. And we always knew that we wanted this to be distributed. And we always had a sense that that would happen and not when. And now, 5 years later, to say, holy cow, this is actually happening. And all of the things that I hold as a founder, I don't have to hold because everybody gets to hold. That I don't have to hold the space for the vision. I don't have to hold the space for the values. I don't have to hold the space for all of us connecting and be the hub through which everything comes, which for some people may be joyful and for me is just like big. And I'd much rather be out doing something else, knowing that there's hundreds of people and thousands of people that are holding the space for this thing, and that the ocean is that thing. And there's something really hugely powerful in this not being dependent on one person, whether it's me or anybody else, that this kind of structure is not dependent on a person. And oh my God, what do we do if something happens to that person? And that to me is almost more powerful than we get to throw away boards, that we get to throw away the whole concept that life begins and ends and centers on the visionary CEO, and oh my God, when that person leaves, the only thing a board says is, we need to find a visionary CEO. if that's held by everybody, you don't need it anymore. And this is so exciting to me. So I'm so grateful to each and every one of you, to everybody that was out enduring the Twitter stuff that we had, to the audio stuff. I'm so grateful to you, Chloe, for having trod this field before us, and for being part of this conversation. So thank you all. And we will be together again on our regular board meeting schedule. And I can see that going away pretty damn quick. Not the schedule, but the board meeting part. Coming together the second Monday of January at 1 p.m. Eastern time. And we'll just keep rocking and rolling. But thank you guys so much. What a gift. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you.